Hard to follow Phil, I'll have to be honest with you. We've been doing this entrepreneurship thing. This is the third year down in Greenville and thrilled to be up here. And I have to tell you, you're lucky to have heard somebody like Phil. He's as good as anybody I've ever heard in all the talks we've had. His unique ability to put his emotions into it and to share is what it's all about. And how thankful are we to be in America? How thankful are we to be in North Carolina and South Carolina to be able to follow our faith and be entrepreneurs? How many places in the world can you do what you've got the chance to do today? Not many, right? I mean, be thankful to be where you are and who you are and have the opportunities you have. I mean, Layton and I joke about it. We both grew up in rural South Carolina. I graduated with 41 people out of high school. Was lucky enough to go to Clemson and see that there was a world out of rural South Carolina. And we laugh now. We look back and say, we never dreamed we would have had the experiences we've had or done the things we've done or had the opportunity to share some successes and some failures with people. And I was really thinking about Phil. Though I didn't go through a bankruptcy early in my career, I was in real estate and I sold a deal to a group and I was counting this $200,000 commission I was going to get when it closed. Well, it comes up to the closing table and the deal's falling apart. And the buyer asked me, well, if you'll roll your $200,000 commission into this as an equity investment, we'll close. So I rolled the whole $200,000 into it, not knowing there was a phantom tax on $200,000 worth of income. Go the next year to file my tax return, and my tax guy tells me that I owe taxes on $200,000 I never got. I had the IRS knocking on my door, too, so I can empathize with that. You know, we all, and Phil's right, I mean, all of us make mistakes and all of us have to learn from them, but I certainly counted money out of a jug of cash change we saved in a jar to buy milk for my one-year-old daughter, so I know what he went through with his family. So, but it's all worth it. I mean, you just keep going. You know, you just keep going. Anyway, so let's go into this. I mean, kind of like Phil, I think part of it is the story. We all have a story. We all have experiences that we learn from. And I'll be honest with you, I wish I'd listened to a lot more people earlier on in my career, because you don't have to do everything the hard way and learn it yourself, right? I mean, that's why you're here, so good on y'all for being here. Grew up in rural South Carolina, Layton told you that, Clemson University. After college, I went back to the family farm and land clearing business, and my dad had the opportunity to invest in one of the very first condominium projects down in Myrtle Beach. And at that point, I come back from Clemson, and I kind of had financial management and agronomy, which is, you know, farming stuff, and came back and pursued getting a real estate license. So I'd gotten a real estate license because he was buying and selling some farmland. And he says, well, these guys want me to invest in this deal in Myrtle Beach. At the end of the day, it was like a $5,000 investment, one huge amount. He says, you got this real estate license. You go down there once a week and see what's going on. So I did, and it was one of the very first condominium projects in Surfside Beach, South End. A $5,000 investment turned into like a $50,000 profit over the course of a year for my dad. And I looked at that and said, I think I can do that. The farm economy was going south, and I'd watch these guys buy the land, put the plans together, sell the units, hire a contractor. So I'd saved up a little money. I'd just gotten married. I hadn't been married 42 years, but we've been married 35, and a good partner is helpful in your careers. And so we moved right after we got married to the beach and got involved in real estate and put another 24-unit project together, optioned the land, spent some money on plans. I had a real estate license, so I started selling, pre-sold the building, and at the point we were getting to the point we needed a contractor to build it, I started, you know, talking to contractors about building it and actually ended up selling the project to a contractor who wanted to move into the market and ended up staying on with that contractor from Eastern North Carolina for about 10 years just putting deals together for him. So, I mean, it was a really good relationship. I sold it to him. I finished out the development, finished out the sales. And it really launched me on a real estate career. And my whole career has been real estate. Stayed in Myrtle Beach in Eastern North Carolina for about 10 years. And then had the opportunity with an attorney partner in Columbia during the RTC days, which would have been the late 80s, was the recession, significant recession we had before this last one. Partnered up with him, and we basically bought deals out of the RTC and out of the FDIC. So we bought about four deals in the late 80s, early 90s, and basically managed to hold on to them with investors until the market started improving, and we would re-entitle them, we'd clean things up, we'd try to make sales, and eventually just flipped all four of them for profits for ourselves and our investor. After we sold the last deal, my partner was having some major surgery, so he was out of commission for 6 months. So for about 2 months, I did nothing, and I got really bored, and a headhunter who would find people for us when we were operating the four deals calls me one day and says, well, I've got a job for Greg Norman. They're in a JV with Macquarie Bank in Sydney, and they're looking for people with a U.S. experience. And I said, well, and he said, would you be interested in talking to him? I said, well, you know, I'm not sure what I'm going to do, but if you promise me I get to meet Greg Norman, I'll go do it. And sure enough, I went down and met Greg Norman, and ultimately wound up getting that job and worked for him for about 5 years in a joint venture with Macquarie Bank. We did deals in Florida, California, Georgia, South Carolina, and Australia. It was a great experience for me because my whole world up to then was kind of the Southeast. And one of the deals we did was a joint venture with Syntex. And so after about 5 years, Syntex approached me and said, we've got a couple deals we got problems with out in the West. Would you come work for us and work on these deals? And as I look back, it was probably one of the best things I could ever do. Norman had allowed me to travel and get a broader view of things, and this allowed me to move my family. We actually moved to Las Vegas, lived out there for 4 years when my kids were in middle school and early high school. And it allowed us to get another view. You know, we lived out west, we traveled out west, and again, it was national in scope. And so I was there for about 5 years. We did deals from New Hampshire to Hawaii. So it was all kind of resort, second home, luxury stuff. And then, and I'll talk about it a little bit later, I mean, you just never know where the road's going to take you, whether you're an entrepreneur or whether you're in a corporate career. I mean, you know, you get to a decision tree, and sometimes you got to go right or left, and it's a big difference about what happens when you get to that point. So anyway, as I'm with Syntex, I get a call for another recruiter, blind call, saying, look, you know, Marriott's in this real estate business. They're Brandon Residential. They're a hotel company. They don't have anybody internally that understands real estate. They see an opportunity. Would you come talk to them? And I'm always kind of the guy that says, it doesn't cost anything to listen, right? I mean, you can always say yes, you can always say no, or whatever. So I ended up going on that and ended up going with them to create a whole new division within Ritz-Carlton for mixed-use development. And in the Marriott world, that basically is where Marriott or Ritz, Marriott owns Ritz, but they build a hotel and adjacent to it as part of the complex. They build condos or timeshare or whatever and brand it and manage it. And so we took that from, when they started, they were making like a 1% fee for branding residential. And we did studies that showed that the brand was adding about 30 to 35% value to the same unit across the street by branding at Ritz-Carlton. So they weren't getting near their share of money and they didn't know how to do it. So in the 5-6 years I was there, we took the average brand fee from 1% of sales to almost 7% of sales. And it took it from basically making $1 million a year. Last year, I've been gone for 5 years, but last year they made $20 million on projects we approved prior to the recession, just with sales. So big business. And that, you know, exposed me to the world even broader. I mean, we were doing deals in China. We did deals in India. We did deals in Malaysia. We did them everywhere. So come 2009 in the crash, a lot of the Marriott deals were having troubles around the world. I mean, it was a global recession. It wasn't just in the U.S. China and India and the Far East came out of it much faster than everywhere else. But we woke up one day and they said, okay, you've all got to cut your groups overhead by 40%. We want you to reduce your size of your staff by 40% in total dollars. And we've got some really good packages. So I said, let me make it easy. And so I took a retirement package, and you heard the rest of the story from Layton. So we started Cirrus in 2009. We've grown from buying one house at a time to doing $20 million deals. We've grown from Layton and myself and our wives driving around looking at stuff in our car. So we've got a staff of 20 people. We've got JVs with other companies. So it's been fun. And in addition to making money, I think it's just as important to Leighton and I, we've added to our community during tough times. I mean, we spent money in Greenville and in Asheville and Spartanburg when it was tough. We've had subs come to us both back in 10 and 11 and say, you know, if it wasn't for the work y'all have given me, I would be out of business. That's different than just paying somebody for service. We had neighborhoods come up to us when we'd buy a house and clean it up and fix it up and say, thanks for buying that eyesore. Thanks for doing what you're doing. So it's not always about money. I mean, there's a lot of satisfaction in business by, to your point, of doing something that creates goodwill and value and helps people. So, you know, it is about money at the end of the day for us in business, but that doesn't mean you can't do good and have a good time along the way. What Leighton asked me to talk about was kind of more the process side and growing a business, because that's kind of all I've ever been involved in, is starting with one and growing. And I'm going to throw in, like Phil did, some lessons learned as we go. You know, everybody's always asked me, is there an aha moment or a big idea? I guess with Bill Gates there was, and Steve Jobs there was, but with me, there's never been an aha moment. I mean, I've never just woken up and said, I've got the idea that's going to make me a millionaire, right? And I guess maybe some of y'all do, and you might, and I wish what you do, but for me, it's been a journey. It's been an evolution of you know, liking what I do. I've liked every job I've ever had. I've never gone and sought another job. The opportunities have just presented themselves, and then you've got to be able to listen and try to make the right decision then. Stay informed. I mean, just my experience is you can never read enough, learn enough, hear enough. I mean, I learned from Phil tonight. You know, if you're not learning, you're going backwards. Even more so in my career in the last 10 or 20 years, you know, the world is changing faster and faster and faster. And good ideas 10 years ago aren't so good now. You've seen what's happened to software, a $17,000 computer. You know, that sat on a table, that'll do more than that computer would do, you know, back then. So you've got to have the attitude that you're going to embrace change, that you're going to, you know, you're going to evolve with it. If we're not, we're going to be stuck on an island. Again, my career tells me be open to opportunities. I mean, I never would have had the succession and the opportunities I've had if I wasn't willing to network and get to know people and learn about what they do and be ready to consider the opportunity when it came along. My career has been about half in the public world, half in the private world. So I think I bring a pretty good balance to it. As an entrepreneur, you've still got to change. You've got to be able to react to opportunities. And similarly in the public world. And then at the end of the day, I'm sure you're hearing from everybody, network, 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 especially if you're trying to grow a company, build brand awareness. You just can never network enough. And it's not only for growing your company or selling your product, but it's for being able to have the opportunities to look at in your career. If I hadn't had a relationship and with a headhunter, I'd have never gotten to Greg Norman. If I hadn't had a relationship with Syntex, I'd have never gotten to Syntex. So those are the kind of things that I think I've learned from my career. And no one opportunity or no one decision is that big, but you start adding them up and you start making good decisions, you'll be surprised where you'll be when you look back 30 years from now. I mean, Leighton and I laugh about it all the time. We'd have never believed we'd live in the houses we live in or have the cars we've had. And we probably now are at the age at 62, we probably spent too much on some of that junk, but you know, what goes around comes around. We're going to talk a little bit about business operations and then we'll get to Q&A. But, you know, as you're building a business, you know, at the end of the day, you're doing stuff all day long and the idea is you want to make a profit, right? So you've always got to be focused on, you know, what am I doing every day and how's it helping me make a profit? That's one of the things you look at. Another one is those tasks that you do to produce the services or the goods. I mean, you've got to be concerned that you're producing something that the market will see as value, right? I mean, you've got to be concerned about how good is the service. With Phil, it was tax stuff. With other people, it's retail. You know, the product's got to look good. It's got to be packaged good. The brand's got to be built. So, you know, it's product and services. There's profit. And then as you start a company going along, you want to do what? You want to start harvesting value. Phil's angels, you know, are at the point they're creating margin, but they're not creating profit. So you've got to move them along and get them to the point where you can harvest that value, right? I mean, you can't continue to make margin and lose money. It just doesn't work that way. And then, you know, the processes and resources that you use to continue to improve your project and to be as efficient as possible. Because as you grow, then it's about becoming efficient, and that's how you create profit out of that margin, right? So you get more and more, and you can make some money on it. So all those things are things, in addition to how do I make another sale, that you have to think about. And so, you know, you're interested in creating recurring income. You're interested in increasing the value of the business, right? Because that's what everybody wants to do, is have a business that's creating profit, that's creating value. And when Phil was talking about why does he do it, because he wants to continue to create value. He wants to continue to do these things. And then at the end of the day, you want to feel comfortable when you go to bed at night after you've been successful with one and two. Okay, so how do I secure this income for my family and my heirs? And he talked to you about succession planning. That's one of the things you'll get into. So it's, you know, it's not just I have a great idea, let me go sell it. It's how do I sell it and make margin? How do I sell enough of them so I can make a profit? How do I sell enough of them and build a brand? How do I sell enough of them that I can create a value for my business? Is where you go. So, you know, it is a process. Layton, I think, I admit I'm a process guy. I've never heard terminal entrepreneur before. I've always accused Layton of being a serial entrepreneur. I think they're one and the same. But, you know, entrepreneurship is a process if you choose to look at it that way. You're going to take an idea. You're going to see that there's an opportunity there. You're going to create a business plans with the things we just talked about. How do I make margin? How do I make sales? How do I build a brand? How do I build value? And then guess what? You've got to execute. It just doesn't happen by itself. And again, I go back to Phil. That's those 100-hour days. That's the execution part. That's when you'd like to go join your friends for a beer at 5 o'clock, but you've got more to do. That's when you'd like to go to your kids' baseball game and you really can't afford to. And that balance, I thought he did a really good job talking to y'all about that balance, but it is extremely hard. And I'll be honest, Layton, I don't know many successful entrepreneurs who've won on that balance early on. I mean, wouldn't you say? Entrepreneur after entrepreneur that ends up being successful will tell you that is probably one of the toughest things of it, and it's a price you have to pay. And, you know, if you recognize that up front, you know, go for it. It's just tough. And so, you know, I'm not sure what all your businesses are, but typically if you're looking at process, you know, you might be looking for a location. You might be looking for equipment. You gotta have labor to put whatever it is you do together. And then you have a process, right? I mean, these are all cogs in the wheel. Nothing happens by itself. In our business, we take capital, right? We do acquisitions. We do due diligence, but then ultimately we do acquisitions. We have to asset manage those acquisitions. They're not going to just sit there and make money by themselves, right? And then we actually have to either then rent something and make a profit or margin on renting, or we have to sell. So, you know, those are kind of the cogs in our business. And does any of that happen by itself? No. That's why we got 20 people. That's why we got partners. I mean, you know, that's why we hire contractors. But it all has to, any one of those cogs messes up, guess what? You got a problem, right? So what gets in the way? Y'all tell me, what gets in the way of what you're trying to do? Are these fair comments on what gets in the way? You know? I'll comment on them in a minute, but I want to see what y'all see. Anybody? No? I mean, you know, a lot of times CEOs are big idea people or operations people. They're rarely both. Layton and I see the world about as close to 180 degrees difference as you can ever see. We like to joke when we're looking at something, I'm looking this way and he's backed up to me looking at that way. But the good thing about being a partner with Layton is we talk about it, and sooner or later we're looking over here somewhere or over here somewhere, and we agree it makes sense or it doesn't. So I would highly recommend, if you're one or the other, very rarely are somebody both, you need that partner can look the other way that you can, okay? Or an advisor or a trusted friend, I mean. But get input. Don't think you know everything. Resources, I mean, what gets in the way? There's never enough resources, is there? I mean, Phil, you know, told you about what happened to him in a startup. I mean, he ran out of resources. Now, to his credit, he stuck with it and was successful. But there are never enough resources. You can't ever do all you want to do. That's why you work the 60 to 100 hour weeks as an entrepreneur, where if you work for somebody else, you could go home up to 40 or 50, right? I mean, that's why you're an entrepreneur. You know, and a lot of people think it's great working on the idea. I mean, there's emotion, there's excitement about having a good idea, but at the end of the day, as you grow, right, and you get up to 20 people like us, or 50 or 600 like Phil, guess what? You got to start managing people, right? And managing expectations and communicating. And a lot of people, in my experience, really have trouble holding people accountable for what they're really supposed to be doing, you know? When you see something getting off track, sometimes it's awful hard to have the conversation you need to have to pull it back or to get it on the right course. And in my experience in real estate, that's probably one of the absolute biggest things as you grow a company. Certainly in my experience has been in real estate, but I'm sure it's the same in Phil's business or any other business. As you grow, you've got to hold people accountable. And then the other thing is the fear of failing. I think Phil's prospect theory kind of laid that out for you. You know, can I try to save it all, or I just want to write off 2/3 of it? I'd rather try to save it all. I raised my hand both times for that one. And I think that's the difference between somebody who's content with a job versus somebody who's an entrepreneur, who wants to be an entrepreneur. Any comments on that? Y'all feel free to jump in.
Leighton raised his hand the other side on both of those two, as I did.
Well, see, that's why we're totally opposite.
I know, but I would have said it'd been the other way.
I didn't want to start talking about that, but I'll tell you this. Here's one fact that we didn't have. How much did we have when we were risking it all?
Yeah.
That's right.
You know, if that $200,000 would have been everything to me, I'd have gone for $200,000.
And that's a fair point.
If I'd had $2 million in the bank, I'd say, that's good for all of
us. That's right. So, that's right. I mean, he's totally right. Any other comments on any of this? Yes, sir.
Just real quick, maybe expand on how you've been affected at holding people accountable. That's a very difficult thing to do. What works for you?
It really is tough, and it goes, I mean, everybody says you got to have good people, and you absolutely do. Don't sacrifice on talent. There's one of the best books I've ever read in business, I'll tell you, is Good to Great. I try to read it every 2 or 3 years because it is so good. You don't put or keep people on the bus that don't get the job done. It's really tough to have to let somebody go, but if they're not producing, if they're costing you opportunity or costing you mistakes, you have to deal with it. We've just reorganized our company. It wasn't very nice. We had to let 3 people go, okay? But we had to do it to go to the next level with our business and to do the things we have to do. I think the best way is hire good people. You've got to have enough planning and internal meetings so that everybody buys into your business plan or your annual operating plan or your annual budget. Because if there's not good people and there's no buy-in, you're never going to get there. And then if you buy in, you know, my sales guy, if he buys into, we're going to sell $10 million in real estate this year, and halfway through the year, we're on track to sell 25% of that. That don't work, right? So, you know, you have to say, you know, look, we're off plan. What do you need? We have the resources, so what do you need? And then if you don't get their attention, there's nothing else you can do. So, you know, you just have to communicate. Everybody has to buy into what the short-term and long-term goals are. You have to talk about it. And then sometimes you have to talk one-on-one. Look, you know, we're not where we need to be. What do we have to do? Good question. Yes, sir?
Follow-up question. Do you use job descriptions and list expectations on the job
description? We have job descriptions, yes, expectations. But more importantly to me is we go through a budgeting and annual plan process. you know, with our business. And, you know, we expect to raise X in capital. We expect to do X in acquisitions. We expect to do X in sales. And if that gets out of balance, you can look at P&L pretty quickly. And we'll talk about P&Ls and financials in a minute. You can, you know, it's not hard to figure out when things aren't going the way they're supposed to go if you have the process and you do the things you need to do as a manager. And I know we're talking about, you know, a $100 million company, and we're talking about things that, you know, you may not be thinking about, but you need to think about that even when you're making two or three people and they're small decisions, because they add up and they can kill you if you don't pay attention to them. Ready to move on? So we talked about, you know, you can do all the stuff and then it gets down to execution, right? To me, it's all about what are the two things I got to do today? And we'll talk more about that in a minute. But everybody, every department, every group, there should be priorities every day, and you need to focus on what are the priorities. You can't jump over here and jump over there and do stuff on the run, because it just doesn't work. So, and then you need to identify and act on leading measures first. We talked about P&L. I mean, you know, when you're running a business and you produce a P&L by the second week of the month for the prior month, you can look at it and you can tell, am I doing what I'm expected to do or not? It's right there. I didn't get sales. I spent more than I should have. That's knowledge. That's power. But so many entrepreneurs, from my experience, don't focus on that. And, you know, to me, if you're not up on the financial side of your company, that's the biggest risk you got. It really is. You need to create a scoreboard. I'll show you an example of one of ours in a minute. So, you know, every couple of weeks, well, we've got a new one, a week, should have printed it, but we've got a weekly scoreboard now that where we're focused on sales. That's where we're lagging right now, where we'd like to be. And so we have a scoreboard by fund, by project of the sales we're getting. And we talk about it every week, and there's focus on it. And guess what? Now that we're looking at it and focused on it and talking about it every week, guess what's happening? Our sales are picking up. Okay? So, and then you've got, back to the question earlier, you've got to have a forum for accountability. We have our senior staff meeting every week. We have, with our development and construction partner, we have a monthly meeting where we roll out the financials, we talk about what's good, what's bad, what's working, what's not working, what resources need to be brought to help, whatever the case may be. And yes, we're a bigger company, but you can do that with your partner, with your two associates, or with your wife. I mean, Phil was doing all that with his wife early on, you know, sounding like she was the accountant. So, I mean, it's that part of it, to me, is totally scalable. You know, any entrepreneur that doesn't know his financial status and whether he's kind of on track or not is ready to fail, in my opinion. Here's one that we use monthly. We've got a more focused one on sales, but, you know, we track, you can read them down the left, but those are the number of properties owned, the number rented, the cash on hand, all kinds of things that we have. That's a combined scoreboard, so we kind of have a global one, and then we have that follows this per fund or per deal. So whatever it is to you, and it shouldn't be any bigger than that. I mean, you want to get it on half a page, right? So you can focus on it, so you can prioritize it. Okay? It might be widgets sold, the cost of widgets sold. It might be that basic, but if you're not tracking it, you won't know. Lessons learned. How many of y'all think you're good at multitasking? Really?
I
think it's a myth. Okay? I honestly do. And there's been some data out there. You can read the slide. I mean, I'm sure some people can, but I try to watch my kids and some of our younger employees, and they're on the phone and they're on the computer and they're trying to do this, and, you know, they're making mistakes, and, you know.
There might be a new term for what it is I do. You know what I mean? Because I agree, and I have gotten to where it's like I want to focus and get the thing done, so I'm not doing several things at one time.
Right.
But I quickly move from one thing to another.
Well, that's so, a little different. That's prioritization and moving through.
Just to defend myself.
I mean, how many of you really think you can multitask? It's just difficult. I mean, And you can blame it on me and Layton both being 62, but we both have two or three priorities on any given day that we want to focus on. And if we get to more than that, that's wonderful, that's great. But I'm on Outlook. It took me a while to get there. But I print out my Outlook calendar every day, and on it in handwriting, I write down the two or three priorities I've got to get to. So that when I'm looking at it, I print it out, it sits on my desk, and that's how I manage.
One thing also is, in reality, when you're running a business, you're forced to multitask. There is no other way out. I mean, it's not about prioritizing. You have to get through. You've got four people on the floor.
Well, you may have to change priorities as the day goes along, but I just find it hard to see how you can be on the computer and on the phone and talking to somebody all at the same time. So, and anyway, I mean, for those who can do it, great. I just honestly can't. Yes, sir.
You mentioned earlier about the big idea guy and the operational guy.
Right.
And rarely do you see an entrepreneur that's both of them, but in a lot of cases, well, for me anyway, I am that big idea guy.
Right.
And I got to do the execution. Now, is that considered multitasking, or how would you?
No, I wouldn't consider that. To me, multitasking is when, you know, when I'm sitting here trying to do something on the computer, I'm trying to talk to somebody on the phone and somebody's head's in the door talking about something else. If you're the big idea guy and you're at the point that you have to do the execution, then it's a matter of prioritization of what have I got to do now, right? And people do that. I mean, people are successful at it. It's just tough. And if you realize it's tough and you can use some of these tools, then it gets easier. Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
Okay. Anybody else before we move on? Personal technology. You know, again, I'm 62 years old, and I remember those early PCs, and I've been tough to adapt to a lot of stuff, but I've had to, and I have. But, you know, I think we're all bombarded by text messages and email to the point of it keeping us not focused on what we should be focused on. Okay? Do y'all see that? Do y'all agree with that? Or am I just being written off as 62 years old and not hip? Yes, sir.
I just have results with that. Put a client on a technology diet 4 days a week.
Yeah.
And you're 44% more efficient.
Yeah, I believe in it, and you have to use it. But I've seen people that say, "Well, I don't answer my phone until 10 o'clock in the morning. You know, I get a couple hours in focused on email, and then I don't look at email again until mid afternoon." I mean, it really irritates me, the people that send me an email at 10 o'clock and at 10:15, the second one, well, you didn't respond. Like, I'm sitting there 24/7, waiting to respond. Layton laughs at me. I turn my cell phone off at 8 o'clock after dinner. I'm done. Okay? So if something's burning down, you better have my phone number because you're not going to get me. So, I mean, I know it's all important, but I just think it goes back to how you use it and how you prioritize it and how you make yourself efficient with it. It's all important. So, you know, what's the best way to do it? I just think it's, if you try to do everything all at the same time, it's a recipe for disaster.
I wonder if, like, the kind of deeper, because I struggle with that, you know, where I'm just like bombard myself with my technology, and I want to, you know, right. Not that I'm going to send you an email 15 minutes later, wonder about.
Well, I mean, I've had people do it. We've all had people
know,
do it.
I do know something about that feeling though of like I'm wanting a response.
Well, right? Call me.
Right. Well, but what it makes me think about. And not to take too much, but basically it's like that you're aligning yourself with your true goals and like what you really are supposed to be doing, rather than what's outside
right.
For you, what other influences exist.
I mean, I think you need quiet time. I get up at 6 in the morning most days. I'm a morning person. I wake up, I get up, I have coffee, I read the paper, and I think about the two or three priorities I've got. I mean, you know, I spend about a half an hour in the morning just thinking about what have I got to do today? What's important, you know? Without the phone going on, without looking at email, you know? They're different tricks. I'm just sharing what's working for me or has worked for me and what I've seen not work for me and not work for other people. It's balance, I mean, you know, at the end of the day. Outcome versus process. You know, people really look more at the end result, okay, in a lot of cases, than the steps it takes to get there. Okay, and I admit I'm a process guy. But if you don't have a roadmap to get to A to B and turn here and turn there and do this and do that, you're never going to get where you want to go. Okay? So, you know, when you're thinking about, oh, I'm going to sell 200 widgets at $100 a margin and I'm going to make this profit, that's wonderful and that's exciting and that's emotional and that's what gets you going. But you better figure out the steps you got to do along the way sooner than later. Any comment on that? I mean, it's none of this is rocket science stuff, but it's stuff that I've seen work really well and the lack of it work really bad for people. No? Personal metrics. Again, we're coming back to kind of, you know, if you're the entrepreneur, if you're the guy that's signing the note at the bank, you're the guy that's bringing food home to your family, how can I be better personally? You know, we talked about having that list. We talked about creating quiet time, you know. Do you look back and kind of think about what you did at the end of the day or the next morning? Do you think about, did I do the things I was supposed to do that I should have done? I mean, I'm guilty on all those counts from day to day. But if you get into the habit of really looking back, whether it's at night or the next morning, I do it the next morning. I think you'll find that's an extremely good tool. You know, did I really do what I was supposed to do? How can I do better tomorrow? Priorities. It's easy to say you got to have priorities, right? I mean, we all know that. Again, it's not rocket science. And this is where, you know, to me, you can't intend to do something. You better schedule it, you know? And to me, it's scheduling through the week. It's the three or four handwritten things on that. That's what I print out every day. And I just write on it the three things I've got to do. Or the two. Sometimes it's only two. Comments? I'm about done. Giving back. Now, Phil's giving back clearly through his family, through his angel investing, right? I mean, I think we've been given much in America. We've been given much by God to be able to have the opportunities we have. And Layton and I both have a long history, and we're proud of it, of giving back and trying to help. And I think as you start down the road of whatever you're doing, you need to be giving serious thought to, at this point in my life, what can I do to give back? I think you're involved with a nonprofit. For a comment about a nonprofit here. You know, we make a living by what we get. We make a life by what we give. I mean, I don't know anything any truer that can be spoken. You know, we've invested, I talked to you earlier about how proud we are to have invested in properties and doing things during the recession. We started in 2009. It was tough. I've been in business since the late 70s. I've never seen anything like 2009 and 10 in my career, okay? And it could happen. The scary thing is it could happen again tomorrow. I mean, it's a world economy, and one thing rattles the next. You know, we sponsor this program in Greenville. This is our third or fourth year. Before that, we did a program called Ecoplosion. We're proud to be up here helping Western Carolina with this. And, you know, Phil gave back tonight in a big way, I thought, to this room. We you know, so we do that. I'm involved with Clemson Universities. I'm a founder of the Masters of Real Estate Development Program. Been on that board since we founded the program 11 years ago. I teach a course every other year in the spring. So if anybody has any interest in the real estate development, I'll be glad to talk to you about that. Layton's always giving back with helping entrepreneurs, speaking at entrepreneurial things. He's on the board for what board are you on? The Venture Capital Authority. And I'm on South Carolina Development Economic Authority. So we go, you know, we give our time. We go to Columbia once or twice a quarter. Don't get paid, but it's just trying to make things better for all of us. So I would challenge all of you to think about how you can give back. And to your point earlier, if you give, you will get. And I thought that you had a brilliant idea for Phil about buy one, give one. I think that's an excellent idea for his business. Questions? Come on now.
What do you look for in a good real estate project today in this environment? What are you looking for?
Well, you know, with us, you know, I've been through the cycles. I mean, I don't know how I'm still in real estate given the cycles we've been through since the 70s, but you know, for us, it's we want to be in good markets. To us, it's right now we're focused on Columbia, Greenville area, up here, and over in the Clemson area. And we're focused on projects that can get done in 3 to 5 years. So we're not looking for any big 10, 20 year projects. And we're looking for projects where we do not compete with the national home builders. So we have a space in good markets where we can do more than the typical home builder can do, one or two at a time, but we want to stay under the radar of the REITs and the, what the national guys can do. So that's our focus. We have a project in Weaverville. We're going to do about 100 single family homes. We repositioned the project up there, and we think it's a 3 to 4 year project. We have a similar project down in the Clemson market where, again, we bought a failed project. We've repositioned it. We're going to carve off and sell to an apartment developer, an apartment site, and then we're going to do about 100 homes, 150 homes there. So those are the kind of projects we look after. The trick in real estate is you want to feel like when you buy a deal, you've made money by the buy, because so many things can go wrong in time. You want to feel like you've got a really good head start when you buy. Okay, so a lot of real estate guys talk about, I made my money when I bought this deal, not that I've worked 5 years and, you know, done whatever you've done on the execution. So many things can happen in real estate these days, it's scary to me. And I would say that advice holds to a business. I mean, you know, don't get too broad in your time horizons, because we've all seen what the economy can do. I don't know what the market ended up today, but it had another rough start. So how much down?
100%.
Okay, so that's a couple hundred points. You know, so with us, it's, you know, we have to know who our competition is. We want to get in and out in a certain window. And then you have to know your costs and your margins. For us, it's all about margins and just building through a program in a consistent way. Yes?
I'm curious your advice for, talking earlier about like stick to what you're good at, and which I think is a good thing for me to remember. You know, so you know, I am the creative type, so I need to find people who can help on the business end and the financials, and you know, and planning.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just curious too, because I think that I really feel like whatever's the most natural. If I can stay aligned with who I am, what my core values are, and just continue to, you know, stay focused, that the natural course, like it'll take place, and I'll put work in, you know,
right.
but that I just have to trust like what will happen naturally on some level, and I just wonder if that statement or statements if they trigger any particular advice.
Well, I mean, I think that's. That's the path I've been on. I've never done something I didn't enjoy. I've always believed you have to network. I'm not always the best at networking. I'm not near the networking guy that Layton is. He absolutely enjoys it. I think, well, I've got to go to this event. But I put on a game face and I go do it. And I'm always glad I did, you know, but it's tough sometimes. But, you know, if you're doing what you like, if you're open to opportunity, if you're networking, And there's balance in your life, although I will tell you, early in my career, I had the same problems Phil did. It's tough to get where you want to go and have the balance you want to have with your family. But if you do that, things come to you. I never went looking for a job in my career. I've been blessed. I freely say that. But Layton's the same way. I mean, he's evolved from one thing to the next to the next, you know? And it's because he's doing what he's got a natural ability to do and what he likes doing. So, you know, just don't force yourself. You know, just flow with who you are, I think is the trick. Yes, sir.
So you talked a little about team and mentioned that they work well together. So walk me through the process of identifying a good partner. How long does it take? I mean, sometimes you're good friends with them, sometimes you meet them on the street or somewhere. I mean, talk maybe some of your experiences about identifying partners, ones that weren't a good fit, and how you knew.
Sure.
That kind of stuff.
Sure. Again, you know, That's a tough question. I mean, it's kind of unique with Leighton and I. We've go back so far together. I mean, we've known each other, like Leighton said, since we were 17 in high school. And what we laugh about is I think he's still who I knew he was when he was 17 or 18, and I think in some ways I'm still the same person. And we look around and see people that back in the day we thought were losers or bad. Guess what? They're still losers and bad. I mean, you can train people to do stuff, but you can't change their character, okay? So, I mean, it's getting around good people. It's taking the time to get comfortable with them. Like Leighton said, it took us 6 months. It wasn't 6 weeks. It was 6 months before we actually pulled the trigger on Cirrus. And that's a lot of time, but we weren't rushed to do it. So I think you just have to do your own due diligence with potential partners or potential companies you're going to go to work for. I mean, you know, when I went to Norman, you know, I had a relationship with a headhunter. I trusted him. I knew, you know, I knew he was looking out for my best interest. He wasn't just trying to hire somebody. When I went to Syntex, I knew the guy, you know, I knew the Syntex guys. I mean, it was no... The only one I've kind of gone too fast was Marriott, but with a brand like Ritz-Carlton, it was just an ideal opportunity for me, and it worked out. So I just think you have to, like any business deal, you got to take your time, you got to get to know what you're getting into, and do your due diligence, you know? Check references, do due diligence. Yes, sir.
I know in real estate, I would, from an outsider perspective, there's usually a lot of balls floating in the air at one point or another. You talk about balance and knowing when to shut things off. How do you mentally shut things off? Because I mean, sometimes I've been in times in my life when you wake up and all of a sudden those floodgates open and there's no way you go back to sleep because all those things flooded.
Yeah, I mean, that just really takes the 6 a.m. thinking through and the prioritization. I mean, Leighton knows we have 2 or 3 deals a week that come through one way or another to my desk or Leighton's desk. And he's forever, what do you think about this one? I'm sorry, I hadn't got to that one. I'm still working on this one. So it really is a process of what's the priority, you know? We try to look at everything. We never say no without looking, but sometimes I have to tell people, geez, I'm sorry, I've got 2 deals on my desk that we're pretty well into, and I probably can't take a serious look at this for a month. And either they accept that or they move on.
Just as the optimistic vantage point is driven partially by creating the thoughts, yes, I can make that play, yes, I can make that shot, yes, I can accomplish this. The other part, the operations part, you got to control your thoughts too. You can't be saying this thing's going to fail or if I don't, you know, whatever. You got to be deliberate, and you can't let it run you all night long. From at 8 o'clock at night, Steve has to say no more. Now he's back at 6, and he's opening the door, and he's saying, what can I do? So it's up. The mind control thing sounds like some kind of bad commercial at night, you know, but the book Think and Grow Rich. You know?
Yeah.
Henry Ford said, if you think you can, you're right. If you think you can't, you're right. So you got to be careful, you know, and that, you got to get that under control. If you can't be on, that's part of being an entrepreneur. Again,
hell,
you might as well go do something else.
And you can be entrepreneurial in the corporate world. I mean, you know, you don't have to be your own company to be entrepreneurial. I mean, you know, everything I've ever done in the corporate world was, let's start here and we're growing this business, or let's start here, we're creating a new business within the corporate world. So it's that, Leighton's right, I mean, it's that frame of thought. What have I got to do to grow? What have I got to do to be successful? And to me, it all comes back to what's the priority of the day. We've got a good friend that's been after me for 2 weeks to look at a deal down at Edisto Beach. And I've had to tell him, Terry, I'm sorry, man, I'm focused on 2 other things right now. I can't. Now, give me 30 days, and if it's still there, I'll come look. Might be the best deal ever, but I can't prioritize it to that point yet. Yes, sir.
Don't you think, I'm a serial entrepreneur, you want to call it that, and I've seen a lot of deals and ideas come and go, but feel like a lot of people, and I've made this mistake, is not focusing on that process.
Right.
Because everybody wants to be the star quarterback who's throwing the touchdown, but nobody wants to be the offensive lineman who has to work all week
right.
so that he can do his job.
Right.
So everybody wants the glory, but it comes down to, are you going to put in the time where, yeah, you're coming in at 6 a.m. and you're not leaving until 8 o'clock at night.
Right. Well, I mean, as the entrepreneur, you've got to focus on that, and either you've got to figure out how to do it yourself, or you've got to bring in somebody that fills that void. I mean, that's just the reality of the world. And
what I'm saying is, I think that process is, and you hit on it a lot. I think, you know, thank you, because I think it's understated to a lot of people. I mean, I had to let somebody go because he wasn't, even though he could do the work. Culturally, he wasn't a fit.
Right.
He came out of the corporate world, so he did not understand
right.
just how tight the margins and the budgets are in a small business.
Yeah, I mean, if you go back to that
three-person operation, as opposed to, you know, he's got three people under him just to do his job.
Right.
He doesn't understand the difference in that.
If all those cogs aren't turning together, you got a problem.
Right.
It's that simple to me.
Right.
I don't know where we are on time, so somebody rein us in, but. Well, thank you so much, guys.